things, one of the misconceptions that people typically have is that banks don't like to finance growth. Well, firstly, there's no one who benefits more in high growth times than banks. In all ways, banks want to finance growth. What happens quite often is that banks may not finance growth in the way that people would like to see them finance growth, but the reality is that banks have a responsibility. The other thing is, and it was introduced by the previous speaker, is that we have to understand that there are several tiers of it, and whether or not we have the requisite differential financing structures to appropriately finance growth. There have been very good examples of growth being financed by financial institutions, and bear in mind financial institutions speaks much wider than just banks in our Caribbean, Trinidad and Tobago, Bahamas, Barbados space, and in Central America as well. And we have a lot of success to feed off of in terms of what has happened in Central America. So let's think first of all about this whole idea of growth and about engines of growth. Think about it, and think about the concept of an engine of growth. An engine is something that you're going to put in some input, and you have to have some fuel. But where is the fuel going to come from? And if the engine changes, are you going to use the same fuel? And what role, for instance, does a government play? Because the government is supposed to be the oil more than anything else in this engine that keeps it running. We could have the same engines, but if you treat it differently, we're definitely going to get different outcomes. So what has happened, and we talk about the changing environment, because we're going to talk a bit about the new environment, is that in the new environment, we can't keep running the same engine the same way. The lubricants can't be the same, and we have to ask ourselves, what part is the bank to play? Is the bank going to be the lubricant? Of course not. What the bank is a type of, not even the entire fuel, but an additive to the fuel that of growth in the economy. So that's one of the things that we have to think about. One of the important things, of course, in our space is identifying which are the growth sectors, which are the sectors, and I look at my good friend Dr. Ramphi soon in the audience here, because he likes to talk about this, which are the sectors that are really going to fuel growth in the economy, and then further ask the question, what is the most appropriate financing arm for it? And in Trinidad, we have many different examples of many different tiers of financing that have taken place. We have capital market financing, both in our local capital market, which albeit is very limited, but a lot of international capital financing has flown back into the Caribbean as well. Now, let's think about, for instance, when we talk about the emerging markets, the emerging economies. Coming out of the financial crisis into this new space, the emerging economies have fared much, much better than the developed ones, largely because of the fact, as pointed out, Esteban. Remember, Esteban was pointing out that there was not much leverage in the emerging economies, not as much certainly in terms of the banking and finance sector as existed in developed economies. Now, because of that, we're talking about the emerging economies. The emerging economies are not always going to be emerging. By 2025, I think they say China is going to outstrip the USA. By 2050 or so, India is also going to outstrip the USA. You have Russia coming up there as well. Brazil is a giant. Chile is a giant. And these are not just centers of production. They are centers of consumption. Now, that's a little different from us in the Caribbean. So, for instance, we can't take the model that finances entities and experiences in Central America, or rather, I should say, in the Brazils and Chinas of this world, and then automatically transfer it to our engine in the Caribbean. It's like trying to run a Honda engine is the same way as you run a Bentley engine. Let's hope we're more of a Honda small engine here than we are in the big emerging economies that will actually become developed economies in time to come. Think of this reluctance, like I said. There is no reluctance, I believe, in terms of banks financing growth, because they say, for instance, that banks don't take enough risk in terms of the tourism sector. If I lend money, if I have exposure in Barbados, how am I not exposed to the tourism sector? If I have exposure in Trinidad and Tobago, how am I not exposed to the energy sector? So whether or not a commercial bank may be set up to pump money into a large project and put at risk a big chunk of its balance sheet and its responsibility of managing depositors' funds in that project becomes another issue. Several things have happened, and one of the things that have happened in the Caribbean is I think we're much better at terms of assessing business risk as opposed to financial risk. And this is another thing that people tend to lose sense of when we look into finance growth. Banks have to, or any lender has to, or I should further say, the appropriate lending, the appropriate financing arm will be driven by the extent to which you can balance the financing risk with the business risk. Listen, it's not actually, you're doing no one a favor to leverage up a young business now starting off, which is what a lot of businessmen expect. They want to have, realistically, enough tears as we'd like to have. We are not an entirely developed financial market. I think we've done fantastically well with what we have, but we are not an entirely developed market. We don't have much venture capital funds. We have very thin capital markets in the region. And as a matter of fact, if you look at growth rates, for instance, in the developed and developing countries, I should say, China is going back right up to around 9%, possibly double digit. India is going to be around 7%. Brazil is around 7 to 9% as well. Okay? Look at the rates of growth. Those rates, one of the things we have to talk about with growth is whether or not it's sustainable, you know. And that is not going to be sustainable. It's going to churn and churn and churn, but eventually it will start to come down. And again, like I said, at least when they develop, when they grow, they themselves consume. So there's some sense of them being able to somehow or the other sustain that much, much more than our sense of being able to sustain it. Trinidad and Tobago was almost running double digits for a long time. And we're back now down to some sense of reality, having to dealt as well with the inflationary trends that went with it. So the need of different tiers of financing is a reality. The need of the reality of the thinness of the market exists. The challenges of operating in all these different spheres with all these different currencies, especially if you're a pan-Caribbean bank, also gives you challenges in terms of managing growth. So very quickly to talk about, for instance, what the new environment in the Caribbean is like and what it's likely to bring for us. Well, for one, now we have more foreign-owned local banks. Or should I say we have more foreign-owned local banks, which basically says that most of the local banks are owned by foreign entities. What does that say for local lending practices? I always said that the nice thing about the Caribbean is that it's small. The bad thing about it is also it's small. Because it is small and we can be affected so easily by what happens in the wider world, similarly, because it is small, we have less moving parts and it is easier for us to adjust to the challenges that happened out there. So maybe that is what has saved us. So we may curse our smallness, but by all means, that smallness might actually have been working in our favor. So more foreign banks, more foreign-owned local banks, you're regulated by not one, but two entities. So you have greater, more stringent regulations, and that is simply going to mean that there are going to be better practices in lending. And does that mean they'll finance growth less? Possibly not. I think the approach will be the same. But what you're going to find is a lot more balance sheet management, a lot more short-term exposures. Because of what we faced in the financial services industry in the times gone past, there was a lot of liquidity. And that lot of liquidity meant that banks started to play around with investments instead of direct lending. It happened for a little bit in the Caribbean, but fortunately, and it was referred to by other speakers, fortunately, we didn't get deep enough to be burned or to drown in that mire of bad debt. Therefore, you have greater regulation because of the fact now that you have what has happened in the external space, and because we learn about what has happened in the external space. Even Trinidad and Tobago had its crisis back in the 1980s with certain institutions that failed. Now, for instance, one of the new realities of the new FIA is that banks cannot have a percentage of cannot own real estate companies. You literally have to sell down. What does that say for growth in the real estate sector? So that is going to be another reality in terms of growth. We are going to have, of course, and then there was also a reference to the amount of the scandals, Ponzi schemes. We have the CL, we have the Stanford experiences, and again, we have small communities, and there are going to be fears about financing entities that are questionable. The good thing, again, is that we do know about it. There are good examples of growth being financed. You look at, for instance, and I will quote some of the energy plants that were built up, the methanol plants. They were financed appropriately. They were financed largely by equity. They financed growth sectors. They financed downstream industries. It is important, like I said, to identify where the financing dollar is going to be most appropriately spent. And more importantly, where is the appropriate source of that dollar? You look at the hotel and tourism industry. There have been very good cases of financing growth in those sectors. I think will also continue. The new financing paradigm is going to look at several things. It's going to look at cooperation with the multilaterals, with the export credit guarantee agencies and the like. Prices of debt, yes, there's going to be more in line with what the market should really expect. Will the government be playing a role in it? The government cannot help but be a participant, and you absolutely have to set in place the structures that are going to allow banks and other institutions to take the risk that you want them to take. So in other words, it's unrealistic to expect banks and other financial institutions to finance growth where there is not the infrastructural support and the intent to do that. We have multilateral agencies that are very much in vogue, the IMF, the IFC, the IFC, the IIC, and they are proper agencies to finance growth in the proper ways. I think the challenge we have in the Caribbean is to acknowledge that it has been done to some extent in a proper way, that there will be more opportunities to finance growth, that the rules of the game will change slightly. It might get a little tougher, but at the end of the day, it's better for the region. Thank you.